Hello everybody, Robin here at Toadstool Tarot. Please consider liking and subscribing to my channel. I haven't asked that in a long time. Today I wanted to have a little discussion about favorited decks and backup copies. So how do you feel about buying backups of your favorite decks? And what makes a favorite deck? Now, this is one that I got a week or so ago, I think. And I tend not to buy backup copies so much, although I have had a few. And I tend to buy them if it's something that I really like and it's independently produced, or it's out of print and I can find another copy. Something that seems like it might be scarce in the future. I don't tend to buy backup copies of mass-produced, currently available decks. If I find in the long run that it turns into a favorite and it starts becoming scarce, or I think it might go out of print, I might buy a backup copy. But I've been thinking lately about why do I need a backup copy? Why am I so precious about it? And I mean, I guess partially it depends on how carefully you take care of your decks, you know, or how they're stored. Are they apt to get dropped, banged up, bent cards, wet, dirty, torn? Maybe your cat or dog has chewed on it or clawed at it. Who knows, you know? On the other hand, if you've got a deck in a tin and you're really careful with it, how you use it, you may not end up needing a backup copy. And I have backup copies of all the decks that I personally have created, because I don't foresee them being available forever. I have them on makeplayingcards.com, and I don't plan on taking them down, but you never know, makeplayingcards might go out of business. And then they won't be available. So I have a couple of extra copies because they're very personal to me. They have special meaning because I created them. And some are more special than others. And then there are decks that I buy that I love initially. I think, ooh, I'm going to be really lost if I don't have a copy of this. And I have a copy right in front of me. I just bought it. But what if something happens to that copy? What if I misplace it, lose it, whatever? Am I going to fall apart if I don't have that deck, you know? And then I go and buy a backup and it sits on the shelf. And I found a lot of times decks that are instant favorites have a sort of a honeymoon period, that once you pass the honeymoon, you move on to other things and you're less and less interested. They're less and less your favorites. It's not always true, but for me, it seems to be that I go through phases, something better comes along, and about 80% of the time, decks that are favorites within 6 months to a year or two, they're not favorites anymore. I mean, I still like them, but they're not number ones. They might be number eights on a list or something. And I have two or three decks like that that I was so nuts about that I got backups, and now they're just kind of sitting on the shelf, and even if I lose the original copies, I'm not sure I'm going to be using the backup copies. It's just they've sort of fallen out of favor with me, or have been replaced by decks that I am more fond of in the moment, but who knows, those too might change. And then there are other decks that I get, like this one that I'm going to reflect on, that I initially pretty much liked but had some reservations about. I just kind of wasn't sure. And having used it or worked with it more, I'm falling more and more in love with it, and it's rising higher on my favorites list. Also, this is a deck that came from Make Playing Cards in shrink wrap. Didn't have a box or a bag. I ordered some extra bags from them. They have these little velveteen bags that you can buy, black or purple, and they're only about maybe $2-3 a piece, something like that. And they're perfectly adequate. They've got drawstrings, they're nice, but they're kind of cheap. I mean, it's sort of thin, a little bit stiff. It's not what you'd call real velvet. It's sort of like velveteen or imitation velveteen or something. They're kind of soft, but they're not really lush or plush. And I went to a metaphysical store near me and bought a velveteen bag, and it was like 9-something or almost 10. And I thought, why is this so expensive? It's just like the cheap ones I got, but it's not. This one really feels lush. It's like real velvet. It feels really plush. And it's got a pretty little ribbon drawstring to it. And it's funny that when I put this deck that I'm going to show you in it, it changed the deck, or it changed my relationship with the deck. Somehow, storing it in this, you know, royal purple, sort of burgundy velvet bag that's so lush and so treasure-like, made the deck even more of a treasure and more likable or favorited. And I think part of liking decks is a tactile sensation. So when the deck is in the bag, that plush feel of the bag really kind of makes a difference, maybe even if only on a subconscious level. This deck also, I might as well tell you, it's called the Old Fellow Tarot, and this is the Blond version, or Vintage Old Fellow Tarot, Blond version. And this is very similar, as close as you can get, just about, to the Keishobu Tarot created in Japan in the early 70s. However, that one is stark bright colors, and this is more muted. And that was one of my original reservations, because it's been vintageized. It's had a dirt filter, or an aging filter, a vintage filter placed over the images, that they're not stark white. There are elements of the cards where the colors are stark white, but the card itself is sort of an ivory tone. And they're on linen stock, and you can see a full walkthrough on my channel and in the records there. You'll find it. So I won't go through all the cards. But one of the things that makes this a favorite or embraceable is these are smaller cards. They claim to be bridge-sized cards. I don't know if they actually are or not, but they're smaller than tarot cards, even though they're sort of tarot format, I guess you might say. And you can see here the cards are a little bit wider than a tarot would be, or than the image, which was designed for tarot format, is, because it's centered there. These, because they're linen stock and because of the size of the card, these are very comfortable in my hands. They're slippery, maybe a little bit too slippery. That's another thing. Some cards you might want slippery, some you don't want as slippery. I think these are pretty close to perfect. Sometimes the edges of the cards are a little bit sharp, which these are kind of sharp. And sometimes you don't like that tactile feel. I'm okay with it. They don't have copyrights on them, which I love. The copyrights have been removed from the original. And initially, because I was comparing it to the Keishobu, I wasn't sure if I liked the coloration, because on those, they're stark white and very bright pop colors. And here, they've been kind of toned down. But if you don't look at them side by side, you come to become almost desensitized to the difference. And I'm accepting these as they are for what they are. And another element as to why I love them so much is, since I got them, I've been using them. And I don't know if you find some decks that you love the artwork on, but you maybe struggle to work with them a little bit, or they don't give you perfect readings. These, I mean, so far, and I don't want to jinx it, but every time I've read with them, they are right on the mark. And they are modeled after RWS, even though the images kind of resemble Marseille decks. They have actions and activities on them that resemble the RWS, so they don't have pip minors. And they are also zoomed in a little bit. Like, here's the magician. He's not standing back at a table. He's kind of in your face. And somehow that makes them more approachable to me, being a little bit closer up. Yet they still have all the elements that you need in the interpretation. And sometimes there are little subtle things that are different that are jumping out at me more. Now, I don't know if I can find... I did a spread earlier today. Here we go. The Temperance card. I was meditating on this, looking at it, and I thought, okay, well, look from the bottom up. You've got 1 foot on the water, 1 foot on the land. What happens when water and land blend? You get growth. There's a plant here. Now you move on up the body and you mix that idea of blending water and earth. You think about that. The idea goes to your head, and there it blooms into a flower. And then you've got the wings. Once you've got that idea, let fly with it. Let that idea fly away and fly on to where it needs to go. So I thought, you know, these are little things that you just pick up on subconsciously, subtly, if you sit with the card and look at it for a while. And some cards or some decks are easier to do that than others. And this one seems to be, I'm easing into finding more and more comfort with it. And it's funny, I often use standard Rider-Waite-Smith cards with Pixie's illustrations that I fall back to. I'm at most comfort with reading those images. But I think this one could replace it, or be at least on level with that deck. I'm finding that I'm as at ease with reading this as I am with the RWS. And that's really important, I think, when you have a deck, to find that it almost speaks to you or reads to you, rather than you having to go digging and reading what's there, trying to pull stuff out. Some might say that's laziness, but I think it's more of a comfort level and an ease with which to use a deck. the backs. I wasn't sure if I liked the backs at first. I do now. They're comfortable. They're kind of traditional. They don't really distract from the deck. This deck really feels good in my hands. I have trouble. I tend to like smaller cards anyway. And larger cards are very popular these days. Stiff card stock is very popular these days. Matte finish is very popular these days. And all of those things, I tend to be less comfortable with, or they're less popular with me. So I love the fact that I can hold these in one hand. I don't have to struggle to reach around them. They have a nice weight to them. They have a nice flexibility to them. The linen stock, I don't have too many linen stock decks, has a very comfortable sensation to the feel of it. And the pattern on the linen doesn't interfere with the clarity in the imagery. I don't know, I guess I'm rambling a bit here, but I'm curious as to what makes a deck a favorite for you, because it's not just about the images for me. There's more to it than just the imagery. So you might make a list of the kinds of things that that you need to raise it up in your top 10 to number one. And also what makes it worthy of having or owning a backup. See, that's what I'm contemplating right now, and that's what prompted this whole thing, thinking about how I'm developing a real bond and a real love for this particular deck, and knowing that it's on MPC right now, but the creator might at any moment remove it from her store, her shop, or like I said, MPC could disappear overnight. I'm not saying they will, but it's a possibility. It feels more like more of a possibility than a published deck, mass-produced and published on Amazon, would disappear. But I don't know. They are a pretty big popular company, so who knows? But just over the past several years, I have noticed deck creators have disappeared from MPC that had their work there. So that's, their own impulse. They've decided they no longer like a deck, or they no longer want it available in their shop. There have been several variations of my decks. One of them I've done in several versions, but I've decided I particularly like one of the four or five versions, and I have been debating removing the other options because that one has become my favorite. So I don't know. I'm trying to decide, do I need a backup for this deck, which is currently a favorite? And I'm thinking, oh, I took it to the cafe with me today, and I'm dragging my chamomile tea over my reading area and thinking it'll only take a drip of tea on the card to potentially ruin this deck. So do I need a backup? Do I need to reconsider when I take decks to cafes where I place the liquids on the table, how far away, where they are in relation to the spread I'm working on? I usually put a spread cloth or a scarf or something down under my cards so they don't pick up sticky food residue from a previous diner if the waiter hasn't, wiped the table before I've sat down. You never know. Maybe it was very dark out today. It could have rained on the way home. My shoulder bag could have gotten wet. These cards could have been ruined. So, maybe I need to look out for some other mode of storing them that's, you know, more protective, like a plastic or tin box or something. Or maybe I need a backup. But like I said, I have backups of several decks that I'm not certain I still need them. I don't even use the original original copies of the deck, let alone reach for a backup. The backups are still in shrink wrap or unopened boxes, and I might never use them. I might end up selling them or passing them on. But and then again, there are also times when you love a deck, it falls out of favor, and years later, you become reacquainted with it and reconnected and, you know, love it again. So it's kind of unpredictable, but I should have gone live with this so I'd have a little interaction in the chat. But I'd love it if you'd put your thoughts in the comments below as to how you feel about backups for favorite decks and or even non-favorites. I know people that they like a deck and they'll get a backup. They don't have to love it, you know. And also, what makes a deck a favorite? What are the elements that make your deck your favorite? You know, I think I've listed most of mine. And you know, one of the important ones is the imagery, but the imagery needs to be a style that I connect with, that I like. And also, it's not just the imagery, it has to communicate with me, it has to be readable, accessible. So I have another deck I've got recently that I absolutely love the cards. The images are beautiful, abstract images of cats, which I'm not a cat fan, but I still love it because the images are so great. But it's extremely difficult to read from the images. I can read them from the labels, but the images are so abstract. And sometimes I can intuit from an abstract image, but these, it turns out, are made from artificial intelligence. Is one of those decks which I didn't know when I bought, and I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but it feels like random images. That happens a lot of times with art decks too. People will take an artist's paintings and then apply them to a deck when they weren't designed for that originally. So the thinking process, the connection wasn't there by the original artist or creator. And maybe that's what's going on with the AI deck too. I don't know. But yeah, just because they're pretty doesn't always mean it makes a great deck, you know. There's more to it than that. Beauty's in the eye of the beholder, they say, and beauty is not only skin deep. It goes deeper than that when it comes to tarot decks and whether they're usable, how usable they are, how much you depend on them, how lovable they become, you know. Well, anyway, there's some food for thought, and I'm curious to see what you all have to say. Thanks for bearing with me and listening and tuning in today. And as I said again, please like or subscribe if you haven't already. And I appreciate that. And I'll see you again soon. Bye.